Welcome to this third podcast in the series on brain development, mental health, and addiction. The series can be accessed via afmc.ca. Throughout this presentation, we will be hearing from some of the leading experts on brain development and addiction medicine from across Canada and the United States, as well as case studies and personal testimonials from professionals struggling with addiction. The podcast will also include a series of reflective questions that will link the specific learning objectives with the Medical Council of Canada objectives for the qualifying examination related to addiction. The MCC objectives are organized around physicians' roles as defined by the CanMeds and CanMeds FMU competency frameworks for undergraduate medical education. Today's topic will be an introduction to early experiences and gene expression. We will talk about the concept of epigenetics and how genes are expressed through interactions with the environment, describe the long-term effects of epigenetics, and look at how early negative experiences harm brain architecture, whereas positive serve and return experiences build resilience over time. To begin with, everyone is born with a certain set of genes. Contrary to popular belief, however, genes are not our fate. Each individual has a set of genes that provide cells with a basic blueprint for development and operations, but not all genes are actively expressed or turned on at the same time. In fact, new research from the field of epigenetics shows that our genes are designed to be sensitive to experiences during certain periods of development. Epigenetics is the process by which gene expression is modified without changing the underlying genetic sequence itself. Our earliest experiences can stimulate structural changes to the area surrounding each gene, thereby influencing whether or not that gene is expressed. Dr. Michael Meany is a professor in the departments of psychiatry and neurology and neurosurgery at McGill University. Here he describes the relationship between environment and gene expression.
I'm going to tell you something I think makes the whole field of epigenetics really quite exciting. And it conceptually repositions the way we think about DNA. Now, when we think about DNA or genes or variations in genes, we very often think of it as some static, immutable force from which everything else derives. So genes always seem to be at the front end of every discussion, right? Now, you may, as Tom noticed and others spoke, and Pat Levitt also noted this, is that genes, of course, are not completely deterministic, that the environment will ultimately shape the way in which the gene influences our vulnerability for particular influences. But in all cases, we place the gene at the beginning of the story, and everything follows developmentally from that. I want to tell you about a different way to think about genes. I want to think about genes not at the front end of the story, but very much as in the middle. I want you to think about genes as a biological force that is subject to environmental regulation, that the environment can actually shape the structure and the function of the gene and thus produce differences in behavior and psychological states and brain function in general. So we need, I think, to start thinking about the genome as a far more dynamic force. Now, clearly, we're not talking about altering sequence. But that's not really relevant. The point in terms of thinking about the impact of a gene is what it produces, right? What are the molecules that come from that particular gene? And in that sense, the gene is very much a dynamic force subject to direct environmental modification.
Once changes in gene expression occur, they are stable over long periods of time and can be passed down from parent to child. In fact, environmental experiences such as caregiver-child relationships are actually biologically embedded in our brains and our bodies in a way that influences our behavior and the behavior of our children across our entire lifespan. Dr. Brian Cobb is a professor of psychology and neuroscience at the University of Lethbridge. Here he explains the long-term effects of epigenetics.
So what we've got here is the brain changes, and that brain change is reflected in behavioral change. These are English terms, learning, memory, addiction, they're psychological constructs, but all of these things reflect some change in the brain. One of the things that's interesting here is if you look at things like depression must reflect some change in brain organization and, in fact, neuronal structure. I think I should put these on because I can't see this thing. So how can this happen? Experience alters brain activity, it alters brain chemistry and so on, but the most important thing it looks like is that it alters expression of genes. So you think this is a watch, and it is. I can read the time. I still have the watch on, but I can't read the time. Now I can read the time. If this was a gene, the gene is there. It's not on. Now it's on. So it turns out that there are many ways to turn genes on and off. One is to put a methyl group on that receptor for the gene. You'll see a picture in a second. And if I look at the brain, about at least half of the genes in any given cell are turned off. And that's why bone cells and skin cells have the same DNA, but the cells are very different because different genes are turned on or off. So experiences turn off genes or turn on genes. That's called epigenetics. So the idea is that DNA is constant, but you can have mutations, but basically it's constant, but experiences are turning on and off these genes. This can happen in your parents before you're conceived, and so the gene is turned off, let's say. That off turned off version is transmitted to you, so you now have the turned off version. If it somehow gets turned on in you, it's possible for that turned on version for you to shift to your offspring, and this is how you can have preconceptual experiences altering your behavior. Things that your parents did, or your grandparents, it turns out, did, can actually alter how your brain is organized.
If genes and environment interact to determine the biological structure of our developing brains, then what impact do negative experiences have on our cognitive, social, and emotional development? Well, scientific evidence demonstrates that adverse childhood experiences can become biologically embedded in the development of many of our organ systems. This can result in long-term negative impacts on many aspects of health, including metabolic regulation and cardiovascular health, which can lead to diseases such as heart attacks and diabetes. It also impacts the development of basic cognitive, language, and social skills. Dr. Pat Levitt is the chair of the Department of Cell and Neurobiology at the Keck School of Medicine. Here he discusses the vulnerability of brain architecture to early negative experiences.
Early vulnerability, brain chemicals, neurotransmitters participate in the process of building brain architecture. It's just not that they're acting as neuromodulators, neurotransmitters. They're actually serving as guidance molecules, growth factors, other things that are wiring this system up. So if you tweak them, you're going to tweak the rest of the system, and I'll show you why in a minute. Genes and environment tune these chemicals during development. The neurotransmitters, for example, dopamine, now poorly tuned, will have long-term impact on brain function, particularly related to the systems in which they serve important roles. And one of the things to keep in mind is that this is not cortisol, right? I mean, cortisol's activity is defined by where the receptors are located. In the case of these neuromodulatory systems, as they're developing very early, there are two features that really define their roles, their activity. One is where they're located and where they project to, and they're not diffuse. Serotonin, while it is present in lots of different brain areas, actually has quite very specific patterns in which they grow into certain target areas and mediate particular functions. Dopamine has very restricted domains of the brain in which they act. So one is where they go, right, who they talk to, and the other is where their receptors are expressed as well. And for example, in the serotonin system, Steve didn't allude to this, he talked about one receptor. Serotonin has 15 different genes that encode 15 different receptors, all of which can mediate slightly different modulatory responses. Dopamine's boring and only has 5. Right, and then we get even more complicated because those genes can be spliced into all different kinds of forms. So, the cognitive motivational, what I call reward systems, and social emotional links occur early in development, and the healthy development of these systems matters for long-term outcomes.
It's helpful to think of our brain as not being comprised of compartments housing over 100 billion cells, but rather as an integrated whole that is sensitive to experiences and relationships. Dr. Thomas Boyce is a professor of pediatrics at the University of British Columbia. Here he describes the importance of stable, supportive parental relationships in the brain development process.
I like to think of development rather than within this compartmentalized sort of view of development, that development is more like the growth of a tree that becomes an integrative whole of interrelated areas of maturation that is supported by this extraordinary neurobiological root system or foundation of brain growth. So brain growth is dependent upon a child's give and take relationships with a human caretaker, which actually is the active ingredient, if you will, of environmental influence on development. We know that sensitive, responsive relationships produce stronger cognitive and language skills, enhanced social competence, and better work skills later in school. We know that children are susceptible, are vulnerable to the adverse influences of a parent's mental health status. And we also are learning that there is, at least at present, no credible scientific evidence that other nurturing relationships with care providers in a preschool or at home interfere with the strength of this parent-child bond.
Parental relationships are critical in a child's development, since they are described as the most important serve-and-return relationships that children can experience. Like the process of serve-and-return in games such as tennis and volleyball, young children naturally reach out for interaction with others. A caregiver who is sensitive and responsive to a young child's signals provides an environment rich in these serve-and-return experiences. When a child's caregiver is unable to provide these experiences or provides inappropriate responses, some brain structures may not form as they should. Negative environments, including chronic neglect, recurrent abuse, and parental addiction, can lead to the development of toxic stress in children and can have a tremendous impact on the expression of children's genes. Positive serve-and-return environments, however, can increase stress tolerance, promote positive social interactions, and maximize physical and emotional health. Dr. Judy Cameron, a professor of physiology and pharmacology at the University of Pittsburgh, explains.
Through this process of social interaction, you can really fine-tune a child's attention to things that are important that it is doing so that it will have fun doing those activities, and it will choose to do them over and over again. Because remember, the way we get circuits being strengthened and staying in place is that those circuits get used again and again. Social interaction is a very good way to get a child to use circuits that you're interested in seeing them have strong skills with in adulthood. So there are no magic bullets. Relationships really matter. Positive relationships and quality learning experiences can be promoted both at home and through a range of evidence-based parent education, family support, early care and education, and intervention services. A balanced approach to emotional, social, cognitive, and language development will best prepare children for success in school and later in the workplace. So you're using social information to really get kids to use circuitry that you care that they develop.
So here's a summary of the key points in this podcast. Each individual has a set of genes that provide cells with a basic blueprint for development and operations. This blueprint can be altered through the epigenetic process, whereby genes are turned on or off, or expressed, by interactions with the environment. Environmental experiences such as caregiver-child relationships are actually biologically embedded in our brains and our bodies in a way that influences our behavior and the behavior of our children across our lifespan. If these experiences are positive, they can promote resilience in the individual, whereas early negative experiences can result in a myriad of social, emotional, and cognitive problems later in life. So as we reach the end of this podcast, here are some reflective questions on the origins of addiction. They're based on the CanMed's competencies and address how you will deal with addiction in your practice. 1. In your role as a medical student or practicing physician, how would you integrate and apply what you have learned about early experiences and gene expression? 2. With a view to engaging and empowering young parents, how could you pass on what you've learned about the benefits of positive parent-child interaction? 3. How could you integrate what you've learned about epigenetics when obtaining the personal history and identifying important relationships of a patient with an addiction? We hope that you've enjoyed this podcast on early experiences and gene expression. We welcome your comments in the feedback section at the bottom of this webpage, and we invite you to continue exploring this series as we examine in more detail the core concepts of early childhood development, as well as the types, causes, and treatment of addiction. This podcast series is based on lectures from the Alberta Family Wellness Initiative, a knowledge mobilization initiative designed to translate scientific research into policy and practice. The podcasts were developed by the Association of Faculties of Medicine of Canada, with guidance from a project advisory committee, and produced by Hugh Kellum and Colin McDonald at the University of Ottawa. Narration was done by Hugh Kellum. This project was sponsored by the Norlin Foundation. The complete podcast series can be accessed via afmc.ca.